In January 2013, the Prime Minister announced the intention to offer the British people an in-out EU referendum.
I welcome this policy of changing our relationship with the EU. We have a choice, either renegotiated in or a negotiated out. But what if we did have to leave the EU? And this comes down to looking at the negotiated out. What would that mean for the UK?
Opponents of withdrawal from the EU have used many scare tactics, citing the dangers, such as we'd lose 3 million jobs, it would damage investment, that the UK would lack influence, that we would be all alone in the world.
I want to take a more rational look at the facts and look specifically at Norway and Switzerland, who for decades have prospered and successfully managed a relationship outside of the EU. What can we learn from their experience? This film explores the options for a new relationship for the UK outside of the EU.
I think there's an awful lot of scaremongering going on about the city or indeed the British economy in general if we left the EU. And as an old warrior in the Euro debate, and if I may say so, I think I was right. And a lot of people said at the time we're all mad and unmodern and we should get real and join the Euro and all that business. But at that time, these are exactly the sorts of scaremongering that used to go on. That if we didn't join the Euro, well, the city would be disadvantaged, we wouldn't be able to trade with Europe, and after all, you know, because the Eurozone was going to become such a dynamic economic area, we'd lose out big time. The truth is that none of that happened. So when I hear about all this scaremongering that's going on, I think it's deja vu all over again.
In the 50s, when the EU was formed, you could credibly make the argument that geography mattered, that trade was on your doorstep and so on, you therefore needed to be part of a regional bloc. You could almost get away with that argument even in the 70s when we joined. You cannot get away with it now, given the revolution in communications we've had since, given the internet.
Our previous Prime Minister, Tony Blair, stood on a platform and was elected to Parliament in a manifesto of wanting to leave the European Union. We have swung so far from that position, and I think we've swung in a way that has forgotten our base. I'm very confident that Labour voters in the country want to see a radical change in our relationship with Europe, and that probably a majority of them would come out if we had a vote.
Remember that on the economic front, the other member states will always want to trade with us. I mean, the idea that Germany or France or Spain or wherever, whichever country, Italy, would say, well, we're going to impose such punitive tariffs on you that you won't be able to do what you want, is unrealistic.
Well, I've always said that the UK is the EU's largest customer. It is the Eurozone's largest customer. Do you really do, if you're a business, what do you do? Try and do? Do you actually try to annoy your customer? Do you try and frustrate trade with your customer? Of course you don't. And it just means that because we're such a huge customer with such a large trade deficit, that I think we've got a lot of a bargaining power when it comes to negotiating a decent trade deal with the rest of the European Union. Let's be honest, if they didn't have a decent trade deal with us, they'd be cutting their noses off to spite their face.
But because you are so many millions of people, and you have this great, great, great tradition and history, I believe you will do fine without EU. I think it's actually the EU who has to tell Britain why you wouldn't work outside, and Britain has to tell why you should work inside. I think it's the opposite logic.
In all the time I've been here, I have never heard anyone suggest that we wouldn't at least get the kind of deal that the Swiss have. Even the most anti-British MEPs, even the Giva Hofstadts. Because I think everybody's interests, once the decision had been made for Britain to leave, would be the same. Everyone would want to maximise their prosperity. And in that situation, you know, you might say, what are the other members getting out of it? Well, what they'd be getting out, what the benefit for them is, if you like, the permanent withdrawal of a UK veto and the withdrawal of British MEPs and commissioners and so on. So the more integration-minded countries would be able to push ahead without this constant break. And that is why the deal that you've sketched out, what you're calling for, EEA Lite, has so many advocates among the Federalists here. It's not just a British position.
Britain would be in another place. If you decide to go out of the EU and become independent in a way, you're a bigger country. You have more muscles than we do. We have money, but you have the muscles, and I guess you will have more influence. If you do something like that, it will change the movement in Europe. It would change a lot of things, but we are in the outskirts of Europe.
I think if the United Kingdom left the European Union, we would be doing it because we were very confident about our future outside the EU. I feel that we have lost our whole memory, really, of our hugely important relationship with the Commonwealth. And when you look at the numbers of countries now in the Commonwealth who are very, very high up in terms of economic prosperity and so on, we should be able to work with those Commonwealth countries, our special relationship with them. But also we can build a relationship in some of the countries that perhaps we've not been able to do as part of the EU.
We would, on the day we left, be overwhelmingly the EU's biggest export destination, bigger than their second and third largest combined, which are the US and Japan. Right? Earlier this year, the United Kingdom overtook France to become the biggest export destination for Germany. In a way, that statistic is the only fact you need when you address the question of, will the negotiations be amicable and will we still be left with the advantages of trade?
There is no doubt that we've got a huge trade deficit with the rest of the European Union. For 2012, the actual visible deficit was about 55 billion, which is extraordinarily high. And of course, particularly with Germany, it was very high.
What arguments do you think would actually secure an out vote in Britain?
The experience from Norway through our referendums is that there's one supreme argument that bears, and that is the democratic argument. Any nation should decide for itself. Any people should decide their own destiny. This is the bottom line. And then, of course, we should cooperate. Of course, we should trade. Nobody is against this cooperation or trade between countries. And of course, this has to be regulated in some way. But this is quite different view from the view that all these nations have to get together into one union.
Well, the main reason why I think the Norwegian public, the Norwegian people are skeptical to membership in the EU is that we like to control ourselves. We want to keep our sovereignty. And I think it's quite clear that some of the directives and laws and regulations that come from Brussels, they don't adapt very easily to the Norwegian reality. And I think the Norwegian public sees that, and they find that, you know, it's better to keep the power in Oslo. That's far enough.
I mean, this is rational thinking. Everything else is just politics. So you must be an idiot if you really earn that much money from trading with a partner and saying, if you don't want to play exactly the play I want us to play, then I do not want to sell anything to you anymore. It would be suicide. So I don't think it's just massive propaganda.
It's quite clear that the way this country would leave the EU would be after some sort of in-out referendum. I think it's at the moment it's not clear that any of the other political parties or the mainstream parties would go anywhere near having exit as part of their manifesto. Under those circumstances, it would be for the government of the time, having got the mandate from the people, to decide what is the best negotiated position for this country. And it would be up to them as to how they do it. And I wouldn't want to preclude anything from that. Suffice to say that actually they would be negotiating a relationship with, a new relationship with the United Kingdom, which would be outside the political institutions of the EU.
It doesn't need to be done by threats or by... it's a real negotiation. This is so massive. This is so important, both to Europe itself and to ourselves, and if I may say also to the world at large, because so many issues are involved in this, that it needs to be handled with great statesmanship, but also with good common sense and toleration and a negotiating position. If it turns into a kind of dogfight, that would be hopeless. It doesn't have to be like that. And so my argument would be that what we have to do is to go back to the drawing board, and I would like an association of nation states, which would effectively be something like EFTA.
I've seen more of my colleagues now beginning to feel that this is an issue that Labour has to tackle, and I'm pretty confident that we will get a support for a referendum. And then I think we have to have that debate within our own party, my own party, so that we can have a united campaign when it comes to a referendum across. I think this is much too important an issue to be a party political issue. Yes. And we will have people on all sides of the debate in each party. And I think people are going to have to work together if we're going to get the result that I would hope would happen. What can they do? If we want to come out, we should vote in Parliament that we want to come out, or there is a referendum that we want to come out, and we come out. I never can understand this idea that, oh dear, they'll fine us. We just don't pay. I mean, a lot of other European countries don't obey what they're told to do. So I don't think there's a big... I know there's been a lot of debate about how we come out. To me, it's very simple. We simply say we don't want to be a member anymore. Sorry.
The question of whether or not we leave the European Union, which is the legal constitutional structure of the European Union, is a separate question from leaving Europe. And some people would like to confuse the two. We actually would remain, as we always have done, on the continent of Europe or within the continent of Europe.
When we do leave the EU, if we leave the EU, then it will have to be negotiated properly. This question of just walking out and leaving everybody behind, you know, is just so ridiculous. It's not a helpful discussion at all, because it just gives the impression that we don't want anything to do with the EU. I want plenty to do with the EU. It's just I don't want to be in it.
We're here in Norway to find out a few facts about life outside the European Union. Now, Norway chose in 1973, when Britain joined the EU, not to join with us. And in 1994, there was a referendum, and again, it chose not to join the EU. So we're going to ask a few people about what life is like outside the European Union.
Norway is better off than we are. No question, and the Norwegians know it. 79.8% of Norwegians, according to the last opinion poll, prefer their current deal with all its imperfections to full membership. And can you blame them when you look at the condition that Norway is in? But that said, no one is arguing that we should just join the EEA. Switzerland is a much better model than Norway, but we could do better than either. We could get a sui generis deal because we're much bigger, we're a much bigger export market, we're much more economically significant.
Trade is vital to all European nations, whether they're in the EU or outside of it. Today I've come to EFTA, the European Free Trade Association, to find out what happens for those nations outside the EU, but in Europe, how they negotiate those trade agreements.
Well, EFTA is a small organization and is capable if a big country like the United Kingdom, who even formed in a way and took the initiative to EFTA, would like to join EFTA, I said this would be actually up for our politician to discuss. And even one could even think that EFTA would have to change a bit with such a big country coming in. But again, this is purely guesswork, and it will be up for substantial political discussions. Well, the three countries, of course, Iceland, Liechtenstein and Norway, are fully members, I would say, of the EU internal market, with the exception of agriculture and fish, and of course with this exception of being outside the EU's custom union. Apart from that, they are fully members of the internal market. Then when it comes to the fourth member, Switzerland, they have their own set of bilateral agreements, which covers also many aspects of the internal market. I should mention that the agreement does not cover the common agriculture and fishery policies, the custom union, the trade policy of the union, the justice and home affairs, just to mention a few.
EU membership and the people who were very much opposed to it, it was kind of a seen as a bit of a compromise in the middle, because it was going to give us market access into the EU market, but at the same time we would keep our independence. We do have also some common agreements when it comes to animal health and those issues, but and food safety and so on. But in general, agriculture is outside the EA agreement.
So all this shows in a way that for the EEA agreement we have set up in a way mirrored the EU system so that we have these two sides, and then we meet in the middle in joint committees where we discuss matters with the EU side on a political level.
Switzerland isn't in the European Union, but here is its delegation in Brussels, right next door to the European Parliament. Such is the importance it places on trade and relations with the EU.
I think the Swiss model is quite a good one. Swiss exporters have to meet EU standards when they export to the EU, just as they have to meet Japanese when they export to Japan. But they don't have, with a few very minor and agreed exceptions, they don't have to apply those standards to their domestic trade. And that's the immense advantage that they enjoy over us.
Well, we're partially in the single market. After the rejection of Switzerland EEA membership, Switzerland negotiated a number of sectorial bilateral agreements with the European Union. So in some areas, for example in Schengen Dublin, we're part of the single market. In other areas, we are not.
We're here in Brussels today for the EEA Joint Parliamentary Committee. This is the interaction between the European Parliament and those European nations that are not in the EU, such as Norway, Iceland, Liechtenstein. We also have the Swiss sitting in. They attend these meetings to see how it affects Switzerland. What has been achieved over the last 2 days? Well, I think it's helped oil the wheels of the relationship between the EU and the EEA members and the Swiss members sitting in. And it's, to me, it's a huge insight into how European countries can work with the EU but not be a member state. And that, to me, is fascinating. Well, here we are in the heart of the European Parliament. It's an enormous building, lots of offices and activity. And the question really is Britain best being here as part of this machine with its MEPs and engaging the Commission and the Council, the EU institutions, or are we better outside, having a different relationship with the EU, closer to that of Norway and the EEA, or Switzerland, or even something new? What is best for our national interest?
There are three viable options. Firstly, one based on the Swiss model, the EU's third largest trading partner. The Swiss have tight immigration controls using visas, a large number of bilateral agreements, and of course, access to the EU single market.
The Turkish option sees Turkey as a member of the EU customs union for goods. It is not bound by the EU social and employment laws and has parallel free trade agreements similar to the EU's free trade agreements. Turkey is also enjoying dynamic growth outside of the EU. The EEA option, the European Economic Area, has been adopted by Norway, Iceland and Liechtenstein. They have full access to and are members of the EU single market. Those countries make limited contributions to select EU member states. Importantly, there's no EU control of fundamental sovereign issues.
Under the EEA agreement, Norway is free to control its own economy. It's free of the Eurozone area, it doesn't have to join the Euro, and it's a very successful, wealthy European economy. Agriculture is so important to the Norwegians that it's not covered in the EEA agreement. 90% of what Norwegian farmers produce ends up in Norwegian shops such as this.
There is a fourth model, a new model, my own personal model, which is called EEA Lite. This sits somewhere between Norway's EEA agreement and Switzerland's democratic bilateral agreements. EEA Lite allows full access to the EU single market for UK exporters, but would also offer us much more flexibility on accepting, rejecting, or repealing EU laws for goods and services within the UK. The UK would leave the EU single market and run its own UK market again. Only 8% of the UK economy is involved in trade with the EU, and that percentage is falling as the UK increases exports with the rest of the world. Like Switzerland, visas could play a key part in immigration control. Visas could be limited for those people from economies whose national wage levels are much less than the UK's. This would ease immigration pressures on British housing and British public services. The UK would also regain national control in all areas, including the economy, trade, finance, justice, human rights, energy, defence and foreign affairs. Do you see the EEA Lite as the way to go?
Well, if we could get a deal of that kind and other countries joined us, then I think that would solve almost all of the disputes that are currently poisoning the atmosphere in terms of the constitutional future of Europe. Isn't that potentially quite a good model? In other words, if we could get a free trade-based relationship, what you call EEA Lite, what Jacques Delors calls privileged partnership, what the Union of European Federalists call associate membership. It doesn't really matter what you call it. They all seem to be based on the same broad principle, which is participation in the four freedoms of the single market, but not in the political structures that go towards amalgamation. If we could secure that, my guess is that there would be a queue of countries both within and outside the EU wanting something similar.
All these things will have to be considered when we start, as a country, negotiating our new relationship with the EU. Nothing should be ruled out at this stage. This is all part and part of the debate that we want to have.
And in fact, Norway and Switzerland are both members of Schengen, which is a very big in, which we're not in, and which Ireland isn't. And that is a far more significant integrationist project than research and development.
I'm more in favour of leaving the single market as it is currently constructed.
I have little doubt in my mind that the single market is something that is a disadvantage and not an advantage to this country. There is a great misconception in this country as to what the single market really is. People just seem to think it's a free trade agreement. It's not. It comes with a regulation, full stop. If you want competitiveness to be improved in this country, then we're talking about international competitiveness, competitiveness with the rest of the world. We're not just talking about competitiveness with France. Then actually, the regulations that come as part of the package of the single market are essentially disadvantageous.
The main object to us is to withdraw from all this EU legislation. So we will search for a treaty that gives us more autonomy.
And I think our foot is even bigger than the Swiss, because they have still separate agreements. Even though, of course, they're integrated in a way, it's not as, in a way, automatic as it is from the EEA agreement. We adapt more directly the EU legislation in Norway, although you go through systems, but in Switzerland has more separate agreements with the EU, so they don't take it in as automatically. Of course, the EU wants to have a more of an automatic agreement also with Switzerland. But it's interesting because now, the last year or two, there has really come up more of a debate about the EEA agreement as well. And we're not part of the common market, so Norway is will be a trading partner for the EU. So that means that you can have taxes, customs between the countries. But this is, of course, all regulated through the WTO agreement. So we can have duties, but it has to be within the rules of the WTO. From my point of view, I think it would be good if we could have a lighter version of an agreement with the EU that is not so automatically binding up the EU, the Norway in all these different areas. I think it would be better to have a lighter version.
What's important to us, and very important to me in this debate, is that with the EEA agreement, there are still some policies or some areas of politics that are outside the agreements. And to me, it's very important that we can still keep our sovereignty in terms of foreign policy, agriculture, fisheries, defense, etc. And many other areas that I think it's very important that we can tailor make our own solutions and our own policies, because I don't think that it's a good idea to streamline all the decision making and all the policies and all the rules and regulations, because Europe is so, we're so different.
So would you like the idea of a looser EA, a EA light agreement?
Absolutely. An EA agreement where you can control the bits and pieces and make sure that it doesn't expand and that it's not too dynamic. I think that's the main shortcoming of the EEA agreement of today. It's too dynamic. It needs to be a very firm framework for cooperation. And I think that it's possibly, it's doable, and it's possible to negotiate with the European Union ways of making such a framework. For me, it's quite obvious that, I mean, we have the European Union and Norway. We need each other. We need to trade. We need to cooperate on so many aspects and on so many political arenas. And it's a two-way thing.
Yeah, I think this EEA light idea is a great idea. We currently are in discussion with the European Union of actually negotiating something similar to that. We currently have more than 120 bilateral agreements. The European Union argues that it has become too complicated to manage all these agreements in parallel, and they want to move to some kind of framework agreement, which would be something similar to the EEA. However, knowing that Switzerland rejected the EEA and also would reject it today, we try to make this some form of EEA light, to have some kind of framework agreement, but not such an invasive one as the EEA would have been.
The truth is that if you look at the growing sectors of the world economy, the European Union is about bottom of the list. Ironically, back in 1970s, 73 of course, when we joined, the EU6 as they were then, EEC6, had done exceptionally well, and we were not growing particularly well. And of course, tariffs at that time are much higher than they are today. So it made some sense to join that customs union back in the 1970s. But the truth is the world has moved on for a whole variety of reasons. One is, of course, that tariffs have fallen away because of the activities of the WTO. But secondly, it is because, of course, the EU itself is now such a weak part, a weakly growing part of the world economy.
Do you fear being, or do the people in Norway fear, are they being outside the EU? Tell me about the fear of being.
No, that was a technique that was being used by the yes side in '94. We were told that we would lose 50,000 jobs nearly overnight if we didn't join, and the fisheries would lose out tremendously, all these sectors that would be ruined economically if we didn't say yes. And obviously that didn't happen. Again, I think it's really important that people in this debate, the ordinary people in the street need to feel confidence and they must have the knowledge about the facts. Because otherwise it's very easy to just be, blown away by all these, all the rhetorics.
So what did the opposition in the 94 referendum use to say why you must join the EU?
Well, they said that the EU wouldn't listen to us, that it wouldn't be possible to have a normal bilateral relationship, that we would be... locked outside the world, we would become an outside country that no one would listen to, and we were sort of non-existent in the international community. Innovation, competence in business would lose out. It's not as if we are no longer part of the international community. And also, the international scene is more than the EU. That's also easily forgotten.
They really lied. They really exaggerated as much as they could. They said we would lose 100,000 jobs. Nobody would invest in Norway. The interest rate would go to the skies. We would be isolated. Nobody would speak to us. I mean, they said all those kinds of things, which has proved false, all of them, because Norwegian economy has really gone to the top after 1994. Investments, interest rate is low. We have the lowest unemployment rate in Europe. So this was all false. Happily enough, they didn't reach the majority with those lies. And I call them lies because they were. They knew better. If not, they would be idiots.
They need us almost more than we need them. I think that is a very, very important thing. And we have to have the confidence to be able to say that and not be kind of taken in by people who say doom and gloom. The very same people who are saying doom and gloom if we were to consider leaving are the very same people who said it would be absolutely dreadful and terrible if we didn't join the euro. So, those are not the kind of people that I want to listen to.
Trade is trade. Companies trade. It's not countries that trade. And if there's a good deal there, they're not going to be particularly worried. Companies are not going to be particularly worried if the employment regulations in this country are different from those in Slovakia. It's just not realistic.
EU is not idiots. They want to sell their goods too, and they want to import what they lack. And they lack fish, they lack energy, they lack minerals, they lack people who can buy the goods, and Norway can supply them. So why should they not trade with Norway? Only idiots would say that we do not want to have what you can offer us. So back, if you get rid of all this propaganda and get back to bottom, it's a question of reasonable trade between countries.
then there's absolutely no reason why foreign direct investment should actually dry up. And in fact, it's interesting that when you look at official websites and all this, the UK Trade and Investment, then what they're talking about is actually things like general competitiveness, whether the exchange rate is at a competitive level, your tax levels, your employment laws, your skill levels, your attitudes to work. All these things actually tend to be much more high up the list than being a member of the European Union. I think the key thing is, if we leave the EU, whatever happens, is that we negotiate a decent trade deal with low tariffs. And I can't see why that won't happen or wouldn't happen, given our enormous bargaining power, as we're such an enormous customer, an important customer of the EU. Under those circumstances, and I don't think they're fanciful, I think they're absolutely central to the whole argument, I don't see any reason why the Japanese businesses here should be disadvantaged by our leaving the EU and having a different sort of deal. And I think that would go for any of the investors in this country. And I think the key thing when you're talking about Japanese investment or any investment is that this country remains competitive. That's absolutely vital. You've got to keep your taxes down, you've got to keep your competitiveness up, and you've got to keep your regulations down as you can. Under those circumstances, I see no reason why investment shouldn't continue in this country, even if we left the EU. But of course, if we do leave the EU, what is also very important is that we negotiate a favourable trade deal. But not just favourable for us, favourable our partners or ex-partners in the EU. And they'll want that because we're such an important customer of the EU. We stay competitive, we have a good trade deal with the rest of the EU. I can't see that any inward investor should be concerned under those circumstances. The real worry, and I think there is a slight worry about the city, if I may say so, is if the other members of the EU start being highly protectionist against us. And they do make some pretty antagonistic noises every so often. In fact, they do because we're outside the euro, for goodness sake. I mean, that's already happening. But against that, if there were a threatening of protectionism there, then let's be honest about this. There's the rest of the world. The rest of the world beckons. And you and I know, I think anybody knows, that where, again, is the growth going to come from? But for financial services. And London is absolutely the top centre at the moment. We are, you know, the top man bar none. And under those circumstances, you go where the growth is. And that's going to be in the Far East, it's going to be in Latin America, it's going to be even in North America. So even though there might be some disadvantages, I can see some huge advantages opening up as well.
Do you feel, as a Norwegian, that you're alone and isolated and not un-European?
No, on the contrary. I mean, Norway has an open economy. We are a traveling people. We have always been. We have been merchants. We are tourists. We have students sent all over the world. On the contrary, our relations to EU represents no problem at all being oriented towards our neighbors, Europe and the world.
You know, sometimes I listen to these comments coming out of the EU and I think, well, you do realize there's a big wide world out there, don't you? And that big wide world is pushing ahead in all sorts of ways when you're locking in more and more cost, which is disadvantaging you.
Do you feel alone? Do you feel isolated, un-European, being outside the European Union?
Definitely not. And our contacts with the EU is obviously very close. I mean, we are part of Europe. We have the agreement. We cooperate very closely. And of course, EU is our most important counterpart in terms of trade.
We would be rejoining the wider world. At the time that we're recording this interview, David, we are 48 hours after Switzerland signed a free trade agreement with China. The United Kingdom cannot sign a free trade agreement with China, or indeed with anyone else, because on the 1st of January 1973, we gave up our commercial policy. We gave up the right to sign a trade agreement with anyone. Now, when you bear in mind that China grew at 6.6% last year, while the EU shrank, you can see that the Swiss are on to a good thing.
Was it considered opposing membership of the EU? Have you been made to feel you're extremist? Mm-hmm. Have you been ridiculed?
Absolutely, absolutely. We were ridiculed. Our points of views were made fun of. They would claim that we were extremists, isolationists, that we were against the world outside, that we were frightened of the international community. I mean, some would even claim that we were racists and afraid of, you know, immigration. It had nothing to do with that. I think it should be legitimate to say that there are national interests that are better taken care of being outside the EU.
We just concluded a couple of agreements now last month, so we are now up in 26 agreements with altogether 36 countries. And in addition to that, we are actually negotiating with big countries like Russia, India, Indonesia and other also Central American states, and others are in the pipeline, yeah.
If the United Kingdom actually left the European Union and took some sort of relationship like Switzerland, there's absolutely no question that it would actually be extremely well connected with the rest of the world. It would be well connected with Europe through trade, if nothing else. In fact, bilateral links might mean there are other connections as well. And then when it actually comes to the rest of the world, I think the United Kingdom would be in a better position to actually build up their relationships with those countries, not least of all those of the Anglophone countries, including the Commonwealth, which has been grossly neglected over the years. So I think we'd be terrifically well placed to have an extremely well connected country.
No, we do not feel alone. We have more than 20 free trade agreements with other countries. We've just signed a free trade agreement with China a couple of days ago. So we're quite well connected in trade. We're one of the largest exporters both to the European Union and to the US. I do not think we're alone. However, we do not want to join the European Union since we think it's too centralized. It's too invasive into the sovereignty of our country. We have a very direct democracy that we do not want to lose.
The people who say you have to be in, whether they're Norwegian, Swiss or British, very quickly fall back to being around the table. We have to be there when the decisions are made, we have to be in the room. And of course what they really mean is that they personally should be in the room, which is why you hear this argument above all from politicians and diplomats and civil servants. You almost never hear it from civilians. You do hear it from big multinational corporations. They have a huge vested interest in it. They are, being human beings I suppose, they are understandably confusing their personal presence in the room with the national interest. But you know what? They're two different things.
EU is in deep shit and Norway is well off and nobody can say anything else.
Do you feel under the EA agreement that you can influence a lot of this legislation or not?
Yeah, but we have to be, of course we can have influence on EU legislation, but we have to work a totally different that a member country can, because you also have the European Parliament and you also have, you know, participation in commission, informal working groups, informal working groups, so you are all over. We have to choose our topics, of course. We can't deal with everything. We have to choose those issues which is very crucial, important for Norway to work on. And then we have to, you know, work in early stages in the legislation process. And we have also, we build alliances with other countries, for instance, the Nordic countries.
Well, we're generally not trying too much to influence European Union laws. We believe that the European Union should do what is best for the European Union. On the other hand, of course, we can influence our relationship much more with other areas of the world, with the United States, with Asia. We have much more freedom in talking with other countries outside the European Union, trying to find common grounds. Whereas as a European Union member, you would have to go through Brussels and ask Brussels, we should do more with Singapore, we should do more with the United States, and whereas we can directly go to these countries.
So you accept that being outside the EU, you can't influence the legislation of the EU very effectively, or can you influence it early on?
Yes, early on we can. We have experts, we are members of committees and so on. And when things are very important to us, like discussions about energy or seafood and things that are really important to us, then our experience is that the EU listens. They want our expertise. But all the same, I think that EEA exposes us to too much EU legislation, where I should think that EU should back off, and this should be national interest in the chair.
Well, we do worry about it, and that's why we try to deal with the EU system and try to negotiate have impact on the decision making in the EU in an early stage, so that our concerns are taken care of, because we have a close dialogue with the EU in their decision making process as well, to try to influence it. So that's how we do it.
Look at the bureaucracy that is being built up in Brussels. I mean, they are not responsible to anybody. And they make the laws, and so when we are proposing laws in the Norwegian Parliament, when the minister tells us no, we cannot do that because we are already bound by other laws made by bureaucrats in Brussels, or maybe from politicians in other countries, but we have not made those laws.
When there are areas and policies where we have important knowledge, I mean, Norway has a lot of competence and knowledge on, let's say, on oil and gas and regional policies. We feel that we are really listened to, and that the EU system acknowledges and appreciates our inputs. And then, of course, there are always conflicts of interest, obviously. But those conflicts would be there whether we were members or outside. So there would always be a negotiation, right? But what's important to us is that at the end of the day, the Norwegian Parliament will have to, decide whether these rules and regulations and directives are to be taken into Norwegian law.
No, we do not miss these people. I think we're well informed enough by knowing what's going on in the European Parliament. Even if we had members of the European Parliament, I do not think that these members could make a big difference. They're one out of more than 500. Personally, I believe that politics is being made by a few persons in back rooms here in Brussels. It's not as transparent as Brussels thinks it is, or as Brussels wants to tell us it is, and this is something I greatly dislike. In Switzerland, we have a very transparent lawmaking process. Every law can be brought forward to a referendum, the people can vote on it, and Brussels is, and the European Union is by far not as transparent as Switzerland is. I'm sure it's not only the European Union's achievement. I'm sure there's NATO, there is the European Union. There's also a war tiredness after the Second World War, an insight by all the nations in Europe that we cannot engage again in such a horrible war as has happened then. There's, of course, a strong America. There's a rising China, and all these geopolitical factors together, they led to 60 years of peace in Europe. But it's certainly not the European Union alone that led to that peace.
But NATO is very popular in Norway. It has a purpose. And we understand the purpose, to protect each other, and that we understand. But the EU, we don't really know what it's for. What is the EU for?
And I fear that what will happen if we don't get this right in good time is that we will have a period of dysfunctional instability and a rise of the far right or general disturbance.
Because EU is not promoting peace, It has a record for the, yeah, it's more diverse than that. And I think in the future you will see EU defending its own economical interest. And if it's something that the history book teaches, it's that when a big power has interest to prevent, to preserve, then they use military force. They need military force.
I mean, Europe existed before the EU, and it has nothing to do with the World War II and the history of World War II. Nothing at all. Nazism and communism, these are ideologies, and it has nothing to do with the nation states of Europe. They could just blossom anywhere, and they do.
It is clear from Norway's example that leaving the EU will not result in an economic disaster for the UK, but will benefit the British economy as Britain renews its trading ties with the rest of the world and strips away the EU regulations which cost millions of British jobs.
There's no doubt about it that if you look at Treasury documents, then we are clearly paying a great deal into the coffers of the EU, whatever the other costs may be about trade diversion and about the regulatory costs and all that sort of thing. And I think if you look at the numbers, you're talking about gross payments of, what, 14 billion a year, net payments about 6, 7 billion a year. Those are just the rough and ready numbers, and they vary through the years. But you just think about the way they stack up. These are not trivial when you're talking about an economy which has actually got a huge public sector deficit. We would be well better off if we simply said, no, we'll have a Swiss-type relationship, we might contribute something to the EU, but not anything like the amount of money we do at the moment. I think it would make an awful lot of sense.
The bigger costs, in a way, comes with the EEA, where the three EFTA countries that are part of the EEA also participate in the EU programs, like the big research program, the framework program for research, the educational programs, and a number of other programs, like the new Galileo satellite GPS system, and so on. And that is also based then on GDP, which will be similar to whatever EU country is paying to the programs.
We pay a lot. Approximately, I think it's approximately 3 billion Norwegian crowns a year for a period for a 5-year agreement. And of course, that's negotiated. For me, it's important that we have a say on how that money is spent within the EU. I mean, I'm happy to Norway is a wealthy country, and I'm happy to you know, give some money to the poorest country in the EU for developing infrastructure or social policies, etc. But it is a big issue that Norway should be able to control that money.
When you say, why do they pay so much? The answer is they're opting into it. They're even under the EEA deal, they are not obliged to pay anything like what they do.
And I think that Norway should decide this for itself on a bilateral basis. Which country do we want to help, to support, to make a treaty with, countries that need it and most and are able to use it not to corruption or to pockets for politicians, but to real development for ordinary people. It was in the first years EU had the control of the money, and it vanished. Half of it was gone, and nobody could tell where it was. That's why Norway said, okay, now we want control. And now we can follow the money.
In the early 2000s, the European Union said, well, we expect you to support financially the countries in the East with some funds. We spent more than $1 billion for a number of projects in Eastern Europe, in Bulgaria, in Romania. These funds are about to expire now, so it has all been spent. and European Union is now renewing its demand that it wants another significant grant from Switzerland, another significant donation from Switzerland.
You see, I don't think Norway and Switzerland are the right, because they seem to be paying still a lot of money and not getting a huge amount of power or influence. And I don't see why we should be paying, when you see what we pay now, why should we continue to pay a huge amount? And for what? Why do we need to?
I think the whole debate has to be, what do we want in, as a country with our relationship with the EU? And personally, I would like to leave. I think it's restrictive and costly and all those sorts of things. And I think it's actually out of date as well. I think this is a 1950s thing that's past its sell-by date. Well, we'll leave that on one side. We'd be far better off, I believe, leaving the EU, getting outside their customs block, having our own trade deals with the fast-growing parts of the world economy. And I'm not just thinking about China, but I'm also thinking about the other Commonwealth countries and the United States of America.
I think Britain would have lots of benefits if it had a different relationship with the European Union than it has today. I think one option would be to rejoin EFTA, and from the basis of EFTA, together with these other four countries, Switzerland, Norway, Iceland and Liechtenstein, trying to negotiate a purely trade-related agreement with the European Union, that you lower taxes, you lower tariffs, maybe even for services, but not having the same social policies, not having the same environmental policies, not trying to harmonize every aspect of every company's and person's life.
I don't think there's any doubt about it that if we have a free trade agreement as opposed to the great single market, which is the four freedoms, I'm never too sure about that, but there you go. I can't see any disadvantages of being in that sort of relationship with the other members of the EU. And of course, it would mean that you could start looking at the regulations that are associated with the single market. You see, the trouble is, as business looks at the single market, it says, well, we like the trade, but we don't like the regulations. I'm sorry, they come as a package.
So literally every continent in the world is growing except Europe, and that is our tragedy. We've locked ourselves into this cramped, confined customs union, which is the only bit that is dwindling.
But I really do think it's fundamentally about getting back control of our own country. We have lost so much over the years. The European Union has changed so much. It's gone completely from what people who did vote for a common market way back in 1975 thought it was going to be. I mean, if anyone had said then to people who voted for a common market that, you know, come 2013, you're going to have the European Commission, the European Union deciding whether you can put olive oil in jugs or not on in restaurants. I mean, they would just laugh. And I think it may sound trivial, some of these issues, but they're all fundamentally part of a we know best, we're going to decide, and you, the democratic politicians in the United Kingdom, have very little say.
But there are plenty of customers in the rest of the world, not least in those countries which are English-speaking and common law, and which have the same commercial practices and accountancy practices that we have. Now, if ever there was a natural market, that's it.
I would think that Britain has many possibilities in the rest of the world, and the developing markets are elsewhere and not in Europe.
It is as easy for a company in my constituency to sell to a company in Dunedin as it is to sell to a company in Dunkirk. In fact, it's easier for all the reasons we were just saying. You know, the New Zealand company, unlike the French one, is English-speaking, common law, has the same, if you like, unwritten business ethics, the same resolution procedures. If there's a dispute, it will be arbitrated in a way that both parties understand. None of that is true of the French company, despite 40 years of EU directives and regulations. So the huge opportunity for us as a country is not just to rejoin the wider world and the Commonwealth, but specifically to take advantage from the enormous surge of growth that we have in those English-speaking Anglosphere markets. And by the way, when the chips are down, those are the countries we depend on.
So clearly, if we're outside the EU, then the United Kingdom would be able to think much more clearly, much more freely, as to which of the regulations it should actually impose.
And it will take a long time. I mean, those directives will not automatically lapse on the day that we leave, because directives, at any rate, have parliamentary implementation behind them. So it will take a long time before we've cleaned them all out of the way. But let's turn off the tap first, and then we can worry about bailing out the tub. And there are one or two particularly egregious job-destroying directives that I would put towards the top of the list. The temporary workers directive has put loads of people unnecessarily out of work. The temping was the most common route out of unemployment in England. The REACH directive, you know, huge row about it here 5 years ago. We've all now forgotten and moved on. But you speak to companies in our constituencies, they have not been able to move on from it. The working time directive, there are a number of things that we should be moving to scrap as early as we can.
Directives are mainly used in the area of the internal market, so we might take over actually about 75% of all directives. When it comes to regulations, which are often more of technical nature, and which is often heavily used in the common agriculture policy, which is not part of the agreement, that can amount to more than 1,000, in some years even 2,000 in numbers. And there we might take over like only 10 to 20% or even lower. And since then we have added nearly 8,000 other acts into the agreement. This can be rather broad, far-reaching acts, big directives that people, everybody knows about, the water framework directive, these big ones, or they can be very small, short-lived ones. Every year we take over about 300 acts through our decision-making system here, while the EU might actually adopt about three or four times more on their side, which then are in areas outside the agreement.
I think you have to think distinguish between different types of regulations. Some of them are actually determined internationally, and like the financial regulations to some extent, they tend to be agreed in G20 or the BIS, or the Bank for International Settlements or whatever. Under those circumstances, we agree them. These are international agreements. So we can trade not just with Europe, but also with the United States of America or wherever. Those would stay. I don't see any problems about this. But when you're talking about specific types of European Union regulations, as say the employment regulations, then I see no reason why we should feel any compulsion to retain them if we left the EU. Moreover, I cannot really see how the other countries of the EU would, quote, really discriminate against us under those circumstances, because if they did that, they'd be the ones that would lose out more than we did. I think that's almost true, not least all because of this huge trade deficit.
But the other bonus, obviously, is that we'd get our democracy back. We would once again be able to hire and fire the people who pass our laws, instead of having the supreme decisions that affect this country being taken in Brussels by people who are immune to public opinion. So I think that the constitutional and democratic advantages, although in my view secondary to the economic advantages, are also a huge bonus.
Well, I bring it all back to the issue of democracy, our parliament being able to really decide how this country is going to be run. We're not doing that at the moment. Parliament is less and less important. Most of the decisions that we've taken in terms of very important things have happened. The decision's been taken in European Union, and then we have to either agree to it or not agree to it. And even if we don't agree to it, it's usually too late.
And this means that we have kept also more of the real democracy in Norway, because I think real democracy can only thrive and exist within the frame of a nation.
The European Union is not on the right track. It's going towards more centralization, towards even more integration. It does not give the freedom that a sovereign nation like Switzerland needs. It does not respect our long history of direct democracy, of participation of the people. We decide many things on the lowest level in the municipality. Suddenly these things will be decided in Brussels by people who have no idea of our respective environment, and this we are very against. You could redesign your immigration policies, your free movement of person policies, your environmental standards. You would be suddenly free again to do what is best for Britain and not what is best for the European Union.
It's a feeling when I talk to some people, older people, not necessarily older people, but lots of people, they will simply say, when you talk to them about Europe, you know, we're fed up being dictated to. We're fed up being told that we have to do this. Why are we having to do it when our government hasn't had that in its manifesto? And it's the feeling that the people who are making those decisions in the Europe are not the even the elected MEPs. They are the appointed commissioners. And I think there's a real anger at the huge expense in the European Union, at the way that money is wasted, at the whole way in which expenses are handled, and people feel that it is a small elite of people running the whole thing, and the project of bringing together, getting a closer, an ever closer union, was not what people voted for in this country. But that is where we're going unless we put a stop to it. And the time has come to have that debate and put a stop to it.
National parliaments are the root of our democracy. That is the most important principle of all of them. And that means that our own parliament should be making its own laws, re-evaluating and insisting on the principle of national democracy based on general elections and manifestos. But it's also now getting into a new situation, which is that there are now effectively two governments and two parliaments covering the same subject matter. So you've got the European Parliament and the European government, as it were, and you've got the British government and the Westminster Parliament.
Well, the good thing is not being a member of the European Union or the EEA is that we can have our own policies in lots of areas. For example, workplace policies we can define on our own. We do not have to take over the European Union policies. Free trade agreements that we can sign on our own or together with the EFTA countries is also a very big advantage. We're quite often much faster than the European Union is, since it's less countries and less interests to coordinate. In other areas, free movement of labor, we've had taken over some European Union regulation, but not all of them. We did not take over, for example, the union citizenship guideline, which is very good. Otherwise, we would have much more immigration into our social systems, and this we want to prevent.
It's appalling when you think about the beginning of the Greek crisis. And when Papandreou said, all right, let's have a referendum, he was immediately set aside. This was the biggest threat to the way EU and the Troika had their plans for dealing with the Greek crisis. It was to keep the people outside and put their own people in the office. And this they did in Greek, in Italy, and so on. And no referendums, thank you, because this is the biggest threat to the ideas of the elite. And that is why I'm very happy about the idea that Cameron proposed a referendum in the UK.
On the conference today, I was listening to the Dutchman from the European Commission, and he was talking like he was actually an elected official, that this would be due in Europe. And I was sitting there and saying, well, I'm also European, but it sounds like he is not taking orders from anybody, that he's sitting there and decides for the competition policies of Europe. And he probably is. He probably is.
My travels and investigations show that a negotiated out option is entirely feasible. The fact that this exists as a real option could inform a renegotiated in approach, so we could conceivably renegotiate so many powers that we end up in much the same position but still within the EU.
But my investigation has also shown that leaving the EU and adopting an EEA-light model would be highly beneficial and desirable for Britain. Based on the experience of the two wealthiest countries in Europe, Norway and Switzerland, it's clear that it would be
not nearly as scary as some pro-EU commentators make out.